Hello everybody and welcome to this session. Today we are going to talk about a topic, a hot topic called pornography and how to kill the habit. So before we start, our young people will introduce themselves.
Hi, my name is Joshua and I hail from Anjuna.
Hi, I'm Aditya. I live in Para. I'm a writer.
Hi, I'm Beverly. I come from Miramar. And I'm currently pursuing my MA in psychology.
So before we start, shall we say a small prayer? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Saint John Paul II,
pray for us.
Okay. Now, before we get into what is pornography and what it does, do you know the size of the industry? It's one of the biggest industries today. I've just got some stats for you. In 2002, while there were 470 Hollywood features, there were 11,300 mainstream pornography sites. Between 2001 to 2007, the internet porn industry was between $1 billion to $3 billion. And can you guess what it's worth today? $97 billion. It's the biggest industry and it is not just, it's there to stay. It's grown so much. See, in the last 15, 16 years, from $1 billion to $97 billion. This money could feed about 4.8 billion people for a day. So that's the amount of money that's there in pornography. Now I also want to tell you some statistics about Goa. In 2014, a team from Mysore called Rescue decided to do a survey of 200 young men in Goa aged between 18 to 22. And they said that 75% of those who watch porn said that they would be wouldn't mind getting involved in rape, because the porn that they watch, 47% of them are into watching rape, and this watching rape is creates a desire in them to rape. 40% watch child porn, because as they sort of get fed up with whatever they're watching, and it goes higher and higher. And 50% watch violent porn. Now you may say, are there so many different categories? So they say first there is soft porn. Then as your body gets satiated, your fantasies get satiated with it, you move on to rape porn. And then finally you move on to violent porn. And maybe a lot of the violence and aggression that we see in our society today could be attributed to this, because it's in the privacy of our rooms, since it's the privacy. I mean, you can watch it anywhere, quietly, nobody knows what you're doing. It's your mobile phone and you, or your computer and you. And so many people are into watching porn. One of the schools in Goa, the principal said that they were shocked that the girls had brought a pen drive with violent porn on it. They were shocked that in their school, there were girls watching such things. So it is not just men, it's also women who are watching porn today. Of course, it is more to do with men, I would say. Would you agree?
Yeah, internet porn.
Yeah, internet porn. We're talking about internet porn right now. Preparing for this session, I went through a lot of... I mean, the internet is pretty full of people who have given up porn also, and the reasons they've given up. The word pornography comes from two words, porn and graphy. Porn is a visual... this thing, and graphic is to document what you have seen. So it is like, basically, porn is prostitution. So it is like watching a prostitution in action, you know. So it is not just you're watching something, you're giving. Also, one of the persons who gave up said that one of the reasons he gave up was he found in himself a lot of violence and anger, and he realized that by watching that porn, it was creating this in him, and he said, this is not me. The second reason he gave up is, he said, when I'm in my room quietly with the door closed watching pornography, I'm actually giving rise to an industry. Depending on my fetishes, there are people out there who will go and get the kind of people I'm interested in. So part of human trafficking. And here am I as a person, as a man, fighting against human trafficking, but I don't think that pornography is connected with human trafficking. I don't think that pornography is connected with prostitution. I don't think, because I think pornography is just me and what I'm watching. But I'm giving rise to quite a big industry. So first and foremost, I would like to ask you, why do you think that pornography became so attractive in these last 10, 11 years?
Well, I mean, the root appetite which it caters to is present, and it's always been present, right? I mean, when you have this commandment that whoever looks at a woman with lust in his eyes has already committed adultery, and this is considered a real call to perfection.
Mm.
Why? Because lust is very much present in everybody, right? And it always has been. I mean, pornography is just, I mean, I think it's a great weapon of the devil to play upon this weakness, which is a general weakness in everyone. So it's not surprising that when you have technology, when you have these facilities, I don't think it's that people are becoming are kind of weaker or worse. It's just that this particular weakness of lust can be played on so easily with pornography, and that's what we see happening.
With technology.
Yeah,
so technology has made it easier for you. Before, you had to buy those magazines or watched a few movies, so someone had to give you a video or something like that. But now it's available to you individually in your own room at the click
yes.
of a button, kind of. No? And sometimes they say you just go onto one site and then constantly those sites keep popping up,
mm-hmm.
and you just... Shockingly, they say, the psychologists have said that, see, the sexual activity in a human, especially young boys, starts at 10, 12, and they're interested, they're curious. So some of them have started and they become addicts by the time they're 12 and 14. Do you agree with this?
No, I don't think.
You don't think
I find that, I mean, it may be true, but I don't know if it's exactly the most important thing,
mm.
That how early it kicks in. I don't know if that's so important. I think the more important thing is why anybody at any age, if they watch pornography, they will respond to it. I mean, your body will
yeah.
respond to it, right? So how do you get, how are you able to overcome it? I think that's for me, that's more interesting.
Yeah, but before we discuss how to overcome it, what does it do to you? Any ideas? What does pornography do to you as a person? Beverly, what do you think?
It does affect you. I mean, people would like to say or wouldn't like to admit that it does harm, but it kind of does in many ways. Firstly, your mind is affected because when you see a lot of it, first of all, there's tolerance, so you keep watching a lot more,
yeah.
and you don't realize how far you've reached. So another thing they'd say is that they have control over it, like I can get out of it whenever I want to, but actually they can't. And also, like, at the end of the day, it's all just a performance. I mean, they're just acting there. It's not a real thing. So automatically you have your expectations are really high. So when that's not met with, when you're with your partner or whatever, then, you know, there's other problems that arise from that as well.
I don't think that the age can be a factor, that he starts at a young age. There can be someone who starts watching porn even when he's 35, 45, 50. Wrong habits which are inculcated, maybe due to his friend circle, or maybe it would be he's just at work, he's doing some research for some work, and suddenly comes across this site and he's like, this site is pretty magnificent, it's looking good, this, that. And you know what he self-inculcates, he's like going through things and he goes from one page to the other, and he doesn't know that, you know, it's dragging him down. But he's like, ah, okay, this is good. Then he moves on further, one level up, another level up. For him, it's just like a game. So he goes from level 1 to 2, 3, 4. And he doesn't know, he's engrossed in that so much so that he doesn't know when to get out.
That's true. What the psychologist said is exactly what you're saying. One is that there's an erosion of willpower. The second is there's a numbed pleasure response. After some time, as you say, go from level 1 to level 5, because that no longer excites you. See, it arouses something in you, no? Porn is not just what you're watching, your body is reacting to it. And I mean, it's creating sin. As you said, starts with lust of the eyes, leads to something in your body, and which leads you into sin. And the catechism of the Catholic Church is pretty strong about this. They say it's a very, very grave offense against God.
Yes.
Because one of the important things that leads, I mean, I don't want to say it, but it leads to you doing so many things on your own, which are not right. So, besides this numbed pleasure response, you also have this erosion, and your brain also is undergoing changes. This is especially among teenagers. There's a lot of dopamine which is being released, and that is creating certain circuits in your brain. When they analyze the brain of a porn addict and a drug addict, both are similar. So it is the addiction which is caused by these high levels of chemicals in your brain. So we don't realize what is happening. We're just watching something, but this causing some reaction in us. Something is changing in us. We don't realize it. We don't know, and we don't want to know also. But until we realize that my body now, there's something gone wrong in it. It's not too late. There are changes that we can do, which we're going to discuss. But when I realized, one of the worst things that happens is men face erectile dysfunction. And today, psychologists and psychiatrists are finding younger and younger men coming to them with this problem. And many of them in their marriages are going wrong as well because of this. So, it's become a problem when they realize something is wrong with them. Only then they realize why. Some young men that I read about as well, they have been seeing psychologists, psychiatrists for other things. One is, they have this attention deficiency problem. Social anxiety problem, memory loss and focus loss, and depression. Some have suicidal thoughts, and they couldn't understand what's wrong because they've taken all the medication that they could possibly. They're going in for therapy, counseling, and when this boy decided, I'm going to stop it, I'm going to give it up, when he realized that maybe it's pornography that's causing it, everything changed. So we can reverse it. It's not irreversible behavior. He realized that his focus came back, his energy levels went up, he realized that his mood had improved without medication, without anything, just because he had given up this. So he realized that the way he was responding to it, it had affected his whole body and whole system. He had even failed 2 years of his college. Then he realized, wow, I've got a whole new life. He started music, he started writing, he started doing so many things because he now was in control of his life once again, and he found something to look forward to. And this reminds me, we had a program with youth some years ago, and one of the things at the end of the program, it was developing Catholic leadership. So at the end of the program, they were asked, what would you do, a small change that you would do in your own society? So one of the boys said, in my village, a lot of people watch porn, a lot of the boys. I myself was a porn addict and I gave it up. So I want to work with them. Okay. So about a month later, I said, so how is the project going? He said, no, I realized for them to give it up, they've got to do something else. So get involved in something else that will catch their attention. And one thing I realized, that all boys like bodybuilding and things like that. So I myself are first going for such sessions so that I learn all this, and then I'll train them in it, and automatically, when they give up something, they'll have something else that will fill their life. Now, do you have any ideas of how we could, the young people could get out of this?
Yeah, I mean, the way I look at it is, pornography tries to take control of your sexuality, and it kind of draws your sexuality towards this form of gratification. But sexuality itself is a gift, and it's a good gift of God. So, pornography, I mean, like every evil, it steals, it actually robs you of your life. I mean, the gift that has been given to you, you are robbed of it. So, the first thing is to understand that this is happening, that you are actually being played, you are actually being lied to, and what you actually want from your sexuality, you are not getting any closer to it. You are moving in the other direction. Then you have to start building up and start wanting what God wants for you as regards your sexuality. So this is where prayer comes in. I think, I mean, a lot of people, it's when they are discouraged or when they are feeling kind of cynical, in my opinion, cynical about women or about relationships or these, you know, any disappointment, then they might turn to pornography. Mm-hmm. This is a kind of instant gratification. The fact that it's violent and aggressive and so on, it's what I want at that time, right? Because I'm feeling cynical anyway.
Yeah.
So you have to make sure that you don't lose faith in what you actually want. I mean, what are your dreams? Does anybody grow up dreaming of watching porn in front of the computer? Is that the idea of your relationship with a woman? Mm-hmm. It's like they say, what girl grows up dreaming of being a prostitute? Well, many of them, I mean, not many, but many people do, right?
Yeah, they do end up.
Yeah. So likewise for a boy, I mean, you don't grow up dreaming of this, so focus on what you want, focus on your dreams.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's like he says, you don't cast out evil with evil. You need to cast it out with good. So I think this is an important thing. Turn to prayer. If you're dissatisfied with your life, with your relationships with women, ask. I mean, he's ask and you'll receive. So ask and keep asking. And when you're doing that, automatically these things which you're watching, they will start to look pathetic. I mean, they are pathetic and they will start to look pathetic. And, you know, that is basically you have to go to war. I think if you want to overcome this, you have to accept that you have to fight a war against this enemy.
Yeah.
And it's going to take some time.
It'll take time.
Yeah.
Beverly, you were saying that you had some steps that you could follow.
Oh, yeah, so we've been talking about, even last time with regard to other things, when first of all for any problem you have to admit that you have a problem.
Yeah, I think that's a very important first step.
Yes.
Because if you don't accept it, how are you going to get help? Because even the willpower thing which we spoke about earlier, if you think you're in control of it and you can get out of it whenever you want and stuff, you're never really going to get out of it.
Yeah.
Even how you have for alcoholics and things like that, they have to do the similar things because both of them are addictions at the end of it. See, normally when we talk about these topics, it's more taboo. So you don't want to, like, if you're into it, you don't want to talk to anyone about it. So when you don't talk to anyone about it, automatically you look for information here and there. When your sources are wrong, unreliable, automatically they will try to tell you that all those things are right, it's good for you. And, like,
yeah,
even some doctors would be like, okay, indulging in certain sexual behaviors is good for you, healthy for you. And you'd use that as an excuse, which is all the more reason for you to stay. So
then whom do you talk to?
You talk to someone, I mean, even if you're talking to your friends, if you're like good company, whatever, fine. But there are many other, I mean, when you're looking for, porn and stuff like that online, you have other sites online as well, which talk about, you know, people that have got out of it.
But it's not that easy. That is if you accept you've got a problem.
Yeah, once you've accepted.
So first step is accepting
that
you have a problem.
Yeah,
now suppose many don't even think that they have a problem. They've got to see if they have these other things that we spoke about. Depression, social anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
They have to see these symptoms and realize I have a problem. No?
The simplest way to find out, like, kind of gauge whether you do or you don't, or whether you want to prove whether it's right or wrong. So normally we'd use this theory, okay, God said, I mean, religion says you shouldn't stay. Then not everyone buys that. So if it is not so wrong, if it is so right, why do you have to hide in your room and do it? Why can't you do it openly?
That's a good point.
That's a nice point.
Why is it that you're watching it on your own, hiding, and you don't want others
and
to know
you never
that
admit,
you're...
Like, even when you're talking, you never admit that you're the one doing it, you're watching it or indulging in certain practices. So if it's not wrong,
but now,
Joshua
said, very often it's your peer group that has got you into it. So
you
then
into
with
it.
That group we'll discuss.
So that's another thing. You can't
yes.
blame people also. Because normally we tend to do that. So that would be another step, I think.
So the first step would be admit.
Yeah.
Second is, you see certain signs and symptoms in yourself that are not right. Third one is, why are you all the time behind? When do you do things behind closed doors? It's when you know that something is wrong.
Something is wrong.
When you don't want others to know, don't want others to see.
Yeah.
Don't want others to know what you're thinking. And then choose the right person to go to for help.
Yeah.
Your peers are not going to help you if they themselves got you into it.
Correct.
Unless you have some young people who are different. Or go for medical advice, go to a counselor, go to a psychiatrist, go to a psychologist, go to a priest, because as Aditya said, prayer is one way out. Now you may say, prayer, how will prayer get me out of it? Now you don't have a prayer life. So first thing we're telling you is, connect with your God. Your God is telling you, I love you. The sin, I can help you to overcome. I can help you instead of looking at things in the wrong way, because I created sexuality, I created it for your enjoyment, but at the right age and at the right stage. I created you to believe in woman as your partner and to together to have a certain pleasure in marriage. I did not create you to indulge in fantasies in a fantasy world. It's not the real world you're living in. You're living in a fantasy world.
Yes.
And the fantasy world will never match the real world.
The real world.
And then you have problems. In fact, this I told you that I keep following Jason Evert and his wife. So once when they were giving a talk, one man came at the end of the talk and he said, please tell young people, do not watch pornography. I used to, and it has affected my marriage. Because my wife could never be those fantasies that I had in my mind. She could never measure up to it and always made her feel terrible. And it affected her and the children. And I regret it now, but I just could not get out of it.
Yeah. You know, and coming back to prayer, I think, in fact, this particular issue of pornography, it's one of the, I think, one of the places where you can really see the power of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's the kind of thing where if you talk to anybody, you're most likely to receive some judgment.
Mm.
You're most likely to receive this kind of comment that this is so disgusting, you know.
Yeah.
And whether they say it or not, you'll feel that.
Yeah.
In fact, in prayer is the one place where you will actually experience how merciful God is as compared to any person, right? When you have, so because we think, oh, it's so disgusting, I can't take it to God. You can. I mean, he's not traumatized. He's not shocked by what you've done, right? Or by what you're watching. He's not at all shocked.
Yeah.
So this is something, if a person musters up the courage to take this, because it's again in privacy, you don't even need, of course, confession is very important. I mean, confession is a good step to take if you confess to a priest. But even before that, to acknowledge it, even if you don't want to acknowledge it to a person, to anybody else, acknowledge it to God, and it will already start you in the process. Because, I mean, he will then work in your spirit. I mean, this is, I think, something.
No, I think it's fantastic, and it's important for us to realize this. We often think of prayer as just reciting some formula, and nothing happens to us. Means we don't see the effect. So we say, I prayed and nothing happened. I didn't change. I didn't become better, or that thing remained, the problem remained there. It's because we are approaching prayer in a wrong attitude. Same as you're watching pornography behind closed doors, start praying behind the closed doors as well. Where you can cry. You say, Lord, I don't know what to do. I'm doing something that's wrong. Can you help me?
And in fact, it's good to go straight from one to the other.
Yeah.
Go straight from them. When you fall,
yeah,
go straight to prayer.
Yeah.
And keep doing that and then see what happens.
Yeah.
I mean, this is what I was saying.
No, I think you would get an answer.
Yeah.
And then you realize, oh, the cynical ones would still say it's my willpower that got me out. But actually it was God who was holding you and pulling you out of it.
Pulling your strings at that time. And he was actually putting it into your mind, okay, this is not the correct way. You have to follow this path. This is my path, the path which I have chosen you to follow.
Now, many of our viewers will say, oh, these people are telling us to become good and holy and this. So why are we basically talking about going to prayer or talking about this topic of pornography itself?
I have had friends and other people who are like totally into it, and it's so bad because some of them, this is not like a direct, more an indirect, so a friend of a friend who was so addicted to it that he had like, he'd get aroused every time he saw his own sister or some, you know,
any
and
woman.
It was very scary because I mean, you live with your family members. What do you do then? How do you, you can't run away because they'll be like, why do you want to go? What's the problem? That is one. And another was that they were so, like the whole day, it started with that, ended with that. So we didn't know how to help them. And it's, I mean, there are other people who are in the initial phases of whatever it is. So it's better to address it so they feel like they're not alone and they can get out of it. So that was one of the reasons why I think we decided on having this as a topic.
One important thing is silence. If you're silent, you don't know what's happening. But if you start talking about it, talk to your friends, talk to someone, you start realizing there is something. And when you're silent and quiet and in your own fantasy world and in your own dream world, it's affecting you.
Yeah.
So this program itself, I hope it has just made you aware there are chemicals in your brain that are changing. Your behavior patterns are changing. The way you think, the way you live is changing. And if you don't get out of this snare, as you said, the devil has put around you, your whole life is going to be destroyed. And therefore, it is so important for you to get out. Get out before it gets you. So kick the habit and you will be the better person. All your talents and all your beautiful things that God has endowed you with, you'll come out of it stronger, you'll come out of it better. And I think that's the message we want to leave with you. Pray. We will pray for you too. It's not an easy habit. And from the survey done in Goa 4 years ago, maybe now the numbers have increased. Boys, girls, young men, women, old men, everybody are in it. Get out of it. Don't let the devil get the better of you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank
for a nice
you.
Session.